Namaste. Welcome to the Festival of Bharat. I am your host, Kamal Madi Shetty, and this is Chitti Media. Today, we have a very fascinating conversation lined up for you. We are going to do a deep dive into the Indian economy. We are going to talk about the Indic civilization and also discuss some amazing ideas from a very interesting book. And to do this, we have with us Harsh Gupta Madhusudanji. Harsh ji is a co-author of two fantastic books, A New Idea of India and Derivatives. He is a full-time investor and has in the past worked with some very reputed organizations like Bain & Company, MIT Poverty Action Lab, and elsewhere. He is also a CFA charter holder, and by education, he holds an MBA from INSEAD and is an economics graduate from Dartmouth College. And most importantly, he's one of the most dynamic and young thought leaders in India today, speaking to whom is always a delight and a very enriching experience. Namaste, Harsh ji. Welcome to the Festival of Bharat.
Thank you, Kamal, so much for having me. I request you to please call me Harsh. Thank you for having
Absolutely.
Me.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thank you so much, Harsh. If I can, you know, pick up from something that I read about you, on your YouTube channel, The Long India, and that is that pessimism requires as much humility as optimism. And my first question to you, Harsh, is on those lines. Now, there are quite a few ideas today that I want to explore with you. But the one I want to begin this conversation is with the India story. Now, the economic present and the future of this world's largest democracy that we live in. Now, you have on multiple occasions articulated your views on this and believe that this century belongs to India. And you have put forward a bold forecast arguing that by 2047, India would emerge as the world's largest economy. Can you tell us why you hold this view and what makes you bullish on, as you call it, Long India?
Kamal, thank you once again. You know, as the joke goes, you know, making predictions is very difficult, especially about the future. So all predictions are basically ways of communicating your hypothesis, your thesis. The exact year or the exact sequence is not so important, but the underlying thought process, which is exactly what you're asking me, and I would like to elucidate that. You're absolutely right. I have a thesis, just definitely not consensus. Even though one would say in the last few years, there has been more of India boosterism, as it will in parts of the financial press, in parts of global investing community. But I don't think most people who are investing their money or who are serious academics or serious sell-side analysts or professors or even buy-side analysts are at least publicly saying that, you know, India would be the world's largest economy by the middle of the century or, you know, a few years before that. Of course, 2047 is the 100th year of Indian independence. And, you know, one can say, well, that's just some nationalist masala added in. But, you know, I think the rough timeline is what is important. So before I say why I'm bullish, it's important to understand where we are right now. I mean, India is the world's fifth or maybe sixth largest right now because of the pandemic. We were already the fifth largest in terms of market exchange rates, economy. The largest is the US. The number two is China. Number three is Japan. Number four is Germany. And then right now, basically UK, France and India have roughly the same GDP, 3 trillion or slightly more. Very roughly speaking, Germany is 4 trillion. Japan is 5 trillion. China is maybe 16 trillion, and maybe the US is 23, 24 trillion. So that's the lay of the land as we speak in late 2021 in terms of market exchange rates. In terms of cost of adjusted, which is known as purchasing power parity or PPP, India is already the world's third largest economy, you know, for some time. Again, the PPP is even more inexact a science than market exchange rates because you have to find out what adjustment you need to make for the cost of living. And not everybody agrees on the exact numbers. There are both methodological and empirical issues, but broadly again, in this time, the Chinese economy is the number one. They've already overtaken the US in terms of PPP. Number two is the US. And since we generally speak in terms of dollars, the US economy is the only one whose market exchange and PPP economy is the same size by definition, around 23, 24 trillion. Maybe the Chinese are 28, 29 trillion. I don't remember the latest numbers, and the Indians are, how depending on how you count it, 10 trillion or so, right? And then, of course, the Japanese and the Germans, mostly developed economies, their cost-adjusted living and their market exchange GDPs are not very different. So and then, of course, this is overall economy sizes. Per capita is very different. The Chinese are very behind. Indians are even further behind, right? Because we are behind the Chinese economy and our population is basically North America, South America, and at least Western Europe combined. So there is a long way to go. Now, what has happened, if you look at the lay of the land around till the 1500s or even till the 1600s, actually, most parts of the world, or quote unquote, most civilized parts of the world where basically the economies were agricultural, feudal, and some commerce on top of it. I mean, small exceptions were, for example, Netherlands, parts of Spain, Portugal, UK, earlier Italian city-states. But mostly, most parts of the world broadly had the same standard of living. So your economy's sizes would be roughly proportional to your population. But of course, the population itself was a function of how productive your economy was, how much food you could grow or you could at least trade for by other products. But broadly, there was some parity, right? Which is why historically we say that for most of human history, China and India, in if we would collect see them in a modern collective sense, were the world's largest economies, right? And India, especially if you also count Pakistan and Bangladesh right now, but even without that. And it was Angus Madison says that India was the world's largest economy till about 1080. The Chinese kind of overtook us there, but really in the 1600s, the Europeans started overtaking us. And academics call it the Great Divergence, 1600s, 1700s. And there are many different reasons, theses. It's one of those big topic discussions in economic history that, you know, why did the West grow rich and why did Asia did not? And, you know, people from Prasanna and Parthasarathi to, you know, Angus Madison, I mentioned. There are other peoples like, you know, Robert Allen and many other people who've written about this. Some emphasize culture, some emphasize state capacity, some emphasize luck, some emphasize geography, and often many people emphasize a combination thereof. So roughly till around the 20th century, till around late 20th century, so around till 25 years ago, you could say that the West was still on average diverging from the rest of the world. Although very small East Asian economies, and of course, most notably Japan, after World War II had started catching up. And then of course, South Korea, Taiwan, Hong Kong, Singapore, the last two being city states. But really it was with the rise of China, which started becoming noticeable in the beginning of this millennium. India to a lesser extent, parts of Africa with the commodity cycle, parts of Latin America, Southeast Asia, parts of it, that we started seeing what now we call convergence. So, you know, where this great historical trend of say 300 odd years or 250 odd years, you know, some people started as late as 1820, some started 1750, the exact number is not so relevant. And they start saying, well, that is now turning around. And so these are huge, clearly century long, at least generation long trends. And within those trends also, there are decade cycles up and down. Like for example, the last decade was roughly a strong dollar cycle. So which is why a lot of emerging economies, including India, did not do so well in dollar terms, not necessarily in local currency terms compared to the decade before. But broadly, we can say that the convergence has started. It's still conditional. It's not a strong convergence yet. It's a weak convergence. Some parts of the world are doing better. Now, within this broad macro historical context that I've given you, I am focusing on the India case. So the reason why it's important to give that broad context is India is in some ways much better positioned than other emerging economies. And I'll come to the reasons why, but nonetheless, it is part of a historical trend. Right? And there are huge, my personal bias or limited understanding based on whatever I have read over the last, you know, decade and a half, is that the biggest reason was why the West grew rich, many reasons, including imperialism, colonialism, slavery. To be fair, slavery was there almost in all parts of the world earlier as well. But the main reason was state capacity. They built what we now see as, quote unquote, the modern state or the modern nation state. And the definition is not fixed, but it keeps on changing. That construction of a state allowed them to coordinate their economies in a way that they could be more productive. So which goes against, so which is somewhere between an extreme free market libertarian narrative that, you know, just purely Adam Smith, that they became rich because the invisible hand of the market made them rich and there was nothing the government did, or very little things the government did. To be fair, Adam Smith was for quote unquote public improvements, or the other kind of extreme view, which was like a Soviet Marxist view that now to catch up, you need essentially an authoritarian dictatorship of the proletariat, right? Well, actually what happened was it was somewhere in the middle. You needed state capacity, you needed domestic free markets, but you needed some kind of trade policy, industrial policy, and you needed infrastructure, you need a good education and financial systems. But for that, you need a state. You need collective action along with individual free markets, right? That golden combination is something which India is only now starting to get. And the reason I would say is because in 1947, we became free. 1950, we formed a republic. 1952, we conducted our first elections. 1977, we basically reaffirmed the fact that we will always remain a democracy. And therefore, some political stability was added. In 74, we had become a half nuclear power. In 98, we became a full nuclear power. In 71, we became dominant in what is now known as South Asia, or what we call the Indian subcontinent. And then, of course, 1991 was a huge part, but in this broader context. And the IT revolution, India's story, unlike East Asia, has been more dominated, or at least more focused on the services exports. And we kind of missed on the manufacturing bus a bit, because we kind of went from one extreme of license Raj to zero trade policy and industrial policy in the late 90s. And what we are doing now is we are saying, if we do some trade policy and some industrial policy, like the PLI scheme right now, because our one of our enemy nations, it is, I think, fair to say right now, the Communist Chinese Party ruled state uses economic statecraft in a coercive manner, especially during pandemics and wars. And if you do not have your own industrial capacity, you just can't allow to, like, for example, import steel from wherever it is the cheapest, because it would be very difficult during wartime. So what we're doing is we're allowing foreigners to invest here. We are building infrastructure, but we are saying, nonetheless, make in India, even if you're not Indian, and make for the world, make in India, make for Indians, and you don't need to be an Indian. So that's very different from George Fernandez in the 1970s throwing Coca-Cola or IBM out, right? Or earlier Nehru nationalizing Air India, taking it away from JRD Tata, et cetera, and the corruption and the overvalued rupee, et cetera. So we are now finally reaching a stage where there is a lot of momentum in terms of our demographics. So we are not old yet like Eastern Europe, Eastern Asia, and parts of Western Europe and America. But we are also not primarily children anymore like we were in the 60s or 70s, right? If you look at a population pyramid curve, it's like this now. So in the bottom, it's kind of becoming straight. It's no longer as wide as it is for sub-Saharan Africa right now. So that population, which is right now in the 0 to 20 group,
yeah,
will become the dominant part of the population in 20 years in the 20 to 40 group. So we have a 3-decade window on the demographic side. We have good state capacity. We have political stability. And if I were to just conclude this answer and keep it at a very high level, it's precisely because we have developed a political culture of ruling this massive subcontinent in a self-autonomous sense, self-rule sense, while, you know, not having extreme instability. So even though in local elections, people might have different choices, it seems like in national elections, there is a national sentiment. And I think the last two elections have shown that. And even if somebody else wins in 24 or 29, you know, we don't know what will happen in the future. There seems to be a national sentiment in India, which is no longer just a sum of hodgepodge local sentiments. So I think the sense of an Indian identity, which is no longer just an elite Indian identity, but a middle class and a neo-middle class and a mass Indian identity because of technology, because of most people understanding at least parts of English or Hindi, and people easily traveling from Hyderabad to Bangalore to Delhi to Kolkata, Mumbai, without feeling that they are in a different universe altogether. That, I think, that sense of national cohesion, and there are various manifestations of it. Many people are understandably afraid of too much homogenization. That's also fair. But I think that national identity, which historically just a civilization, not necessarily a modern nation, along with the modern state, along with the infrastructure we're investing, along with that stability, starting from a very low base, part of a global convergence trend, is the real reason I see, along with technology, and I can go into that, but that is the key reason for our takeoff in the next 30 years, which is our peak demographic window. So sorry for a slightly long and roundabout answer, but it's important to get the context where to place India's story in the broader global history of economics.
Please remember to subscribe to us and switch on the notifications for this channel. For our other social media links, more content, and to support our work, please visit citti.net. धन्यवाद, नमस्कार.